The Cellcast is recorded in front of a live streaming audience.
Hello and welcome to another episode of The Cellcast. Joining me today is a man who, well, he's feeling a little batty. Welcome, Jacob.
Blah, 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 but I don't see blah, blah, blah.
No, Adam Sandler, you do not.
No, I don't. Why, thank you. Let me introduce my co-host, a man who just, he had to pick that one shiny sword, and it was a fake. Really? You couldn't tell a real sword from a forgery? Come on, man. Where are you from? It's like, oh yeah, never mind.
I'm from Texas, thank you. The only katanas I ever held were yours.
Okay, fair enough.
Also joining us this evening is a man of many talents, and I don't have a good pun. Welcome, Dallas.
What's going on, guys?
From Geek Devotions.
Yes.
Hello. I'm glad to be here with you guys tonight. It's going to be fun.
Yeah, yes, this is going to be interesting. Yes.
As always.
Especially since, what, at the last minute you realized you'd watched the wrong movie, Dallas?
Yeah, yes. That was a thing. I'm literally pulling it out of my DVD case. I'm like, I'm going to watch the movie. I'm excited. And I look at your message and I go, oh, that's the wrong movie. I was about to do what Paul J. Powers does in every episode of Retro Rewind Podcast.
And watch the wrong movie.
That's hilarious. That was what I understood was be like, okay, he'd already be like, you already watched the live action movie. That's what I understood. It's like, oh crap. It's like, I've got to find the animated one.
It's a good thing I sent you the link to the streaming version,
Yeah, streaming version.
Yes.
Well, we won't talk about how... about that streaming version too much. Mm-hmm. So why don't we go ahead and get into our spoiler-free thoughts on this?
Certified fresh and spoiler-free.
Dallas.
Yes, let's talk about the art here because this art was gorgeous.
This is your spoiler-free thoughts, by the way.
That's that not a spoiler-free thing?
It just sounded like you were going into your first like, that's all.
Yeah, he'd be like, Dallas is so excited to watch, to review this. I'm going to be like, my art is the amazing thing about this. It's like, okay.
No, I mean, it was a really pretty thing. I'm genuinely curious. I haven't a chance to go back into it, but it reminded me of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, some of the art.
Oh, yeah, I can see that.
Yeah.
It's got kind of style.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, definitely. I don't know if that's just a product of the time of when there was being made or not. But the art was interesting to me the entire time through, and I really appreciated that aspect of it.
Yeah. So that's your entire spoiler-free thought about the movie?
There's so much that I want to say that is just spoiled-filled.
Okay.
Totally awesome.
First viewing of the film.
Outside the fact that I've seen this before, and okay. I've seen the live-action version, which is basically a remake of this, but time-jumped 10 years, and I've seen the anime series, and nothing is connected.
I've noticed that.
Like, welcome nothing. To anime.
Yeah.
It's like there's like another series I never got to watch of it, or maybe it's like a movie. It's like, it was Blood Minus C or C Minus.
Yeah, that's the one where they worked with the people who made Cardcaptor Sakura.
Yeah. Hmm. Also not connected, but connected.
No. Somehow, just by name.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm just like...
Loose adaptation from...
Loose is the word. That is the word there, Jacob.
Don't know Lucy Goose.
They're Batman. That's what's the same, I guess. I don't know. I haven't looked at it.
Yeah, that's basically all my spoiler stuff. Like, I have... Everything I want to talk about really goes into, like, the detail of the whole aspect of the show, because...
fair enough.
It's an interesting... Again, it's an interesting story. I feel like that there was stuff that could have been done more... But at the same time, if you're going to go watch this, I feel like this is a spoiler-free item. You have to keep in mind this was originally supposed to be like a 3 or 4 episode OAV.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, this technically makes our first OVA on the show.
Really?
Oh, cool.
Cool.
Celebration.
I got to looking it up, and that's only if you don't count the three mini movies that make up Digimon the movie.
That is true.
That is only if you don't count that.
I don't know.
Because that's technically three OVAs stitched together.
That is true.
That's true.
Yeah,
but the fact of the matter is, like, yes. It's hard, like, how do I put this? Going into it, you have to keep that in mind. This is not a full-length, like, we're calling it a movie?
Yeah.
But it was like, they ran out of money, and they're like, quick, just put it out there, and hopefully we can get more money from it.
Mm-hmm.
It apparently worked since they made sequels.
They made sequels, they made a live-action movie.
Kind of sequels.
Kind of.
Yeah. A manga.
Yeah, they made some money off of it.
Yeah.
Yep.
So yeah, this is my first viewing. I have known of this anime, I think, for at least 15 years.
Because
I think at the time this would have originally made it over here to America.
Mm-hmm.
I was not watching anime at the time. Just because of life and not having time.
That's fair.
So, because that would have been right around the time I was getting out of high school.
Mm-hmm.
And trying to get used to college and work.
Right.
Geek. Anyway.
Life. Yeah, right.
Finds a way. roar. So, yeah, I only know of this from, I want to say I first heard about it from a podcast. I listened to it for an extremely short time that no longer exists. So I'm not going to give them free advertising. But that's how I found out about it. And I remember thinking it sounded cool, but by the time I went to look for it, it was not at Hastings. I miss Hastings. That was my original place to get anime.
All right. Moment of silence for Hastings. You should put like sad music or something.
Where's the violin?
I will edit some in later.
There we go.
I'll throw in a few bars of In the Arms of an Angel from those ASPCA commercials.
Black and white, grays out.
Yeah. So, it wasn't...
Jacob's over here whimpering.
this is one of those that by the time I was looking for it, it was not available. I wouldn't be surprised if... did ADV have this dub back in this release back in the day?
No, this was Manga Entertainment.
Okay, so that would explain it, because I never found Manga Entertainment stuff until other people picked it up.
Right.
So, probably Bandai in most cases, before they got kicked to the curb. But anyway.
You're not wrong.
I knew of this anime. I never got around to watching it, and I was of the idea, it's like, well, as all these other ones are coming out, like the live-action movie and other ones that I was hearing about and finding out, oh, this is not the original? Well, the completionist in me must start at the beginning, but I can't find watch the beginning, so I guess I won't be partaking of these anytime soon. So, yeah, I had never seen this before Jacob put it on the list, and so I had to go look it up and find it. Thankfully, we did find it, because it's not very easy to find anymore. Again, it's out of print again.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So... we will allow you to do the Google research on your own to find this film.
It's not hard.
It's not, but we're not telling you where it is.
The whole thing is hard to find.
Yes.
To find it well. Like, whenever you messaged me about it, I was like, I want to go back and rewatch the whole series just for context for certain things, because the series technically takes place after this movie.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm using quotation marks very bigly, because it's like loosely takes place after this movie. But... like, it's like it. I can't find the series anywhere. I found it was supposed to be on Plex, and Plex is like, nope. And then it was supposed to be on Amazon Prime. Amazon Prime's like, you need a VPN. I'm like, I'm not rich like that. So,
amen to that. Mm-hmm. Like, you can watch it if you're in Japan.
Yeah,
let me move right now.
Yes. Hey, at least with this version, this is spoiler free. You won't have to change audio settings.
That's true.
That is true.
That's true.
It's a one of a kind film in that regard.
I will say that is the biggest thing that surprised me because the thing I said it was the dub.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So I'm just assuming, okay, like any other anime, it's an English dub. I played.
I completely forgot about that.
I'm about 3 or 4 minutes into it. There has been no talking for the first couple minutes. Finally, you get to hear some dialogue, and it's the train announcement saying, you know, if you're getting off of the train, beware the gap, mind the gap, whatever it said.
Right.
But it was in Japanese. It's like,
okay, so maybe they just didn't change it for this because, you know, that's a minor thing. No one's going to care. And then they did speak in English. I was like, okay, this is good. This is in its native English, so I didn't think anything of it. And then we got to the scene, to that other scene with the other three people. I'm not going to say who they were. And they're speaking Japanese. Going, did it glitch out? did the person who put this video up mess up somewhere? No, that's just how it is.
Am I getting played?
I remember getting the
Jacob,
DVD
did you send me the wrong link?
I remember watching the DVD of this. I got it from Hollywood Video back when I was working there.
Oh.
And I remember going, wait a minute, this is, because I turned on, I went to go change, I always go in there and I change the subtitles and the dubbing.
Yeah.
Depending on what time of day it is. Like, normally when I'm watching this stuff, it was like 2 o'clock in the morning because I just got off work. So I was like, I can't handle Japanese today. And I realized, no, there's only like one language track, period.
Yeah.
And I thought that was really unique when I saw it back then.
But we'll get more into that here in a minute.
Yeah.
Jacob, what are your spoiler-free thoughts?
I just want to say this. Yeah, at 2 a.m., the brain is like, I can't think. I can't even think in English right now. Just say it, please.
What are you talking about? 2 a.m. when I was working at Walmart, that was when I did most of my gaming. Because that's about the time I got home.
Night owls. I mean, like, just give me like 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, I'm good. Past midnight, I'm just a sleepy puppy. Just like, let me go to bed. Oh, yeah.
2 o'clock, finishing up Final Fantasy VII. It's like, I'm barely awake, but we're going. I'm going to kick your butt, Sephiroth.
Coming for you, Sephiroth.
I didn't, by the way. I had to do that the next morning.
Wow.
But anyway, Jacob, your spoiler-free thoughts?
Yes. All right. So I think like most people would be like, I had heard of this, like going to Hastings, you know, again, sad moment. Yes. No longer have Hastings.
I miss Hastings.
Yes. We all miss Hastings. In the arms of an angel. So I remember seeing the DVD. I didn't pick it up, obviously. So a couple
otherwise
years,
you'd still have it.
Obviously, I probably still have it. You see my collection.
Yes.
And my wife is like,
she wants to throw some of it out.
Very lovingly. She's like, can you trim this down a little bit? It's only six, maybe 1,000 discs. Maybe more. I don't know.
And how many of those are Warner Brothers discs currently rotting?
Either or. So I'm scrolling through YouTube, what have you, and I stumbled across this one guy who does reviews. I think it's like Been at the Stage or something like that. And again, would I recommend his channel? No, he's a little vulgar, definitely in his earlier years, but he's kind of cleaned up from that time on. But I saw his review over Blood and the Last Vampire, and I was like, oh, that's interesting. I never heard of this. And so I think I saw a little bit of here on YouTube or something like that, the actual movie. I was like, okay, that's kind of interesting. And so we were talking about doing movies for Halloween for this year. I was like, wait a minute, Blood the Last Vampire, because I was looking it up. I was like, wait a minute, I remember that. Let's put that on there. Had no idea it'd be this hard to actually find the movie.
Yeah.
But again, it'd be like the animation.
That is what happens on this show. We think, oh, let's review that movie.
Yeah.
And about 2 weeks before, Jacob, I can't find this movie anywhere. Where? Do you have a copy? No, I don't. Crap.
I've had that happen more than a few times.
Search the archives. In quotation marks.
Archives.
The archive. That is a specific location that people know what it is.
Ah. Fair.
Home of the Wayback Machine.
The Wayback Machine.
Almost had a On the Arms of the Angels moment with them a couple weeks ago.
That may happen any day now, for being honest. They are pushing
their
luck.
DDoS attack, man.
I know it.
Really?
And they're almost in trouble with like a bunch of copyright people too. From
what
they did through what they were doing during COVID, just lending every book they had out to whoever asked for it.
Right.
But
yeah, it's. I find this film or OVA or mini movie, whatever you want to call this.
It was a theatrical film. That's why I'm calling it a movie.
Okay, a movie. It is interesting. It's got, like, story-wise, we're like, shwip, okay, what's going on? We understand a little bit what's going on in this story, but not enough to make a whole story out of it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But, like, the animation is superb. It has, like, like the fact to be like it's a dual language movie from the get go, and I was like, wow, that's impressive. So
the logistics of that in the year 2000.
Oh yeah, 1999. It's not like it would
be today. Today they could do that easy.
Oh yeah,
but back then, whew.
Yeah, because you couldn't just be like pop up to a mic and be like start talking and then ship your file over. No, you literally had to go to the country of origin and then record it.
I'm telling you, somebody had a hard drive they had to manually carry from L.A. to Tokyo.
Probably.
With all these voice tracks on it.
It's like get back and be like someone dunked in water. It's like, oh no, what happened?
That's why you take it in your carry on. It's too important to put down in the hold of the plane.
Why is there fish here?
You're arguing with the TSA guys before there was TSA.
Yes.
Say no, you cannot X-ray this little box here.
Yeah.
Otherwise, this little box of wires. Don't X-ray it, please.
I don't know, son. Be like, this will be fine. Zap!
It's probably
3 hours of work!
It's like in those movies where the government spy and the guy's carrying around a briefcase that's handcuffed to his arm, so he can't let it go. Except in this case, it's not full of money. It's full of a bunch of spinning hard drives.
Yes.
Right?
or a audio tape. Oh, it could have been audio tape at this time.
For how many times people have lost information on hard drives and crashed?
Oh,
my gosh. Like Nate Marchand from Monster Island Film Bolt.
Thankfully, he got most of that recovered.
Yeah, what I understand. But good night. That's always scary.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. So anyway.
Yeah. So, yeah, that is my spoiler-free thoughts for Blood, The Last Vampire.
And why don't we go ahead and jump into our spoiler-filled review of this thing?
The following is a spoiler-filled review for the film Blood, The Last Vampire.
Blah, blah, blah.
Listener discretion is advised.
Blood, The Last Vampire was directed by Hiroyuki Kitakubo. By the way, if I mispronounce anybody's name, if I go Maya on these names tonight, my apologies. I'm going to do my best.
He's going to go Maya by my apology.
Sorry, Saya, not Maya.
Saya.
Orly.
I think when I was watching it, I kept hearing Maya when I was watching the movie. But it's actually Saya. My bad. See, I'm already messing up. He also was in the animation department for Akira.
Ooh.
And he's directed many episodes of TV anime.
Mm.
And it was written by Mamoru Oshii.
Mm.
Getting into the cast, Yuki Kudo is the voice of Saya. And in the movie Memoirs of a Geisha, she played Pumpkin.
Oh,
Pumpkin.
Hmm. Saimi Nakamura played Nurse Makiho Caroline Amano, and she played a villager in Kubo and the Two Strings.
Hmm.
Nice.
Bear in mind, I couldn't tell if this was the English version or the Japanese version. I'm assuming English. Joe Ramursa was the voice of David. And in Street Fighter II, the animated movie, he was Balrog.
Balrog.
Nice.
Rebecca Sorstadt played Sharon. And in one of the Tenchi Muyo OVAs, she played Mihoshi Kuramitsu.
No, for reals?
Yeah.
Let's go.
Dude, I'm going to tell you, I was looking for Gundam references and then on all these things. But the best I could get you was Tenchi Muyo.
I'll take Tenchi, man.
I did see some, but it's like, I have no idea if this is a main character in that show, so I'm not going to risk it. SP Officer Number 1 was played by Fitz Houston, and in something called Crown Royale Street King, he played Pastor Royale. And I only bring up SP Officer Number 1 because SP Officer Number 2 was played by Steve Bloom.
Hmm.
As we know, Spike Spiegel in Cowboy Bebop.
Yes.
And Tom from Toonami.
Yes.
And that one commercial for Taco Bell.
And don't forget the Wolverine.
That's two. Lastly, and I'm going to say that this is a little iffy because I can't find confirmation anywhere, but apparently the sound effects used for the Chiropterans were originally recorded for something else, but they are Frank Welker.
Really?
Yeah. He happened to be doing the voices for them. He wasn't hired for this. They used the sound effects from something else. But he did the original sound. He made the archive audio for it, basically. And like I said, I can't confirm that because there's I have yet to find a sound effects wiki. But many of the other wikis are saying, oh, the Corruptorans are voiced by Frank Welker. Well, why can't I find this on IMDb?
Right.
Kingdom Hearts connections. How many y'all think we have?
Ooh, interesting. I don't know. Dallas?
I'm going to guess 3.
I'll go 4.
Dallas is correct.
Oh!
Let's go!
There is 3. The first one, which should be obvious to Jacob as many times as it comes up, Frank Welker!
Of course!
Who in Kingdom Hearts, it wasn't Dream Drop Distance. It was Birth by Sleep, played Experiment 221 Sparky.
Mm-hmm.
It's the only time he ever did anything in Kingdom Hearts was a sound effect for a Stitch knockoff.
It's fair.
Also, Hiroki Harada, who was a clerk in this movie, in the Japanese dub of Kingdom Hearts, he played Captain Jack Sparrow.
Really? Oh, wow.
And then Katsuhiro Kitagawa, who was a customer in this, is the voice of Pete in the Japanese version of Kingdom Hearts.
Huh. Interesting.
And that's all I got for Kingdom Hearts connections and cast. What do we got in info and stuff, Jacob?
All right. So, info and stuff. It has an IMDb of 5.3 out of 10. Has a Rotten Tomato of 25. You're able to watch it, if you can, watch it on Fandango for $3.99. Let's see, production.
I missed that one.
Yes.
Of course, I don't have an easy way to watch Fandango.
All right, so production was East Wing Holding, SAJ, Beijing Happy Films, Production IG, Destination Films. This film was distributed all over the place, people. Let's just say that.
Yes. And it's all gone now.
Ashmill Ace Entertainment in Japan. Plethora Distribution in France, United Kingdom. Idigo Films in Hong Kong. Samuel Gold Films in North America. And Focus Films in International. Let's see, its release date was May 22nd, 2009, here in Hong Kong.
No, not if it's 2009, because that is the other movie.
Are we sure we're doing the right thing?
2000 is the one we're looking at.
Oh, okay.
This must be the live-action movie stuff, and a little farther you were going. But you said Production IG. I was going to let it go.
Okay. I'll.
Knockoff PaulJPowers.com.
Exactly. You're welcome, Paul.
He was in the parallel universe with me where we were watching the other movie. You're the one that's behind, Drew.
Jacob, I'm going to start calling you JacobBHeron.net. And I'm going to have to go buy that domain before the end of the night, probably.
Oh, my gosh.
The WWW portion stands for Wolf, Wolf, Wolf.
Yes.
Dallas said it. I didn't say it.
Ashley, you can kill Dallas.
Yes. 3 Vayner.
There's very few people who are going to get that one.
I get it. But, all right. So IMDb has a 6.6 out of 10. Rotten Tomatoes is a 50%. And it's 66 audience score. So it's scared a little higher with their audience. It's available to watch on Fandango. If you want to watch it there. Production was Production IG. Distribution here in the States, at least, originally was Manga Entertainment. Its running time was 44 minutes. Its release date was July 27th, 2000 worldwide, and November 18th, 2000 in Japan. So it was released everywhere else except Japan first.
That happens.
Which is weird.
It's rare, but it does happen.
Yeah, that is weird. So going into box office, there's not really a whole lot of box office information about this film. But what I could gather, it first premiered on the 5th annual International Film of Fantasy Action Fantasy Action and Genre Cinema, nicknamed Fantasy 2000, in Montreal, Quebec, Canada, where it was screened for an audience on July 29th, 2000. The film aired in Australia on August 26, 2000 at the Australian the Sydney 2000 Olympic Art Festival, making its theatrical debut in its home country, Japan, on November 16th, 2000. Manga Entertainment released the film theatrically in the United States in the summer of 2001, following a VHS and DVD release on August 26, 2001. Let's see, going in a little further into the home release, in its first week of its North American release, more than 70,000 DVDs and 3,000 DVDs and 3,000 VHS copies of Blood, The Last Vampire were sold. Within the first month of its release, it became Manga Entertainment's top-selling title in its company's history. The film also appeared on both the Video Business Billboard Video Store Magazine Entertainment Weekly's list of top DVD sales. The company accomplished their the marketing, a limited theatrical release before its DVD release to the market, marketed the title and offering the entire film for free on the day the DVD was released through a streaming video broadcast on Snipnik 7.com.
This is the early days of streaming. This is before YouTube was even a dating website.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I think it's like Sputnik 7.com, where it was downloaded more than 61,000 views. Wow. Let's go into spinoffs and sequels. In 2005, Sony and Production IG announced the creation of Blood Plus, the second to last vampire.
Yeah,
second.
I'm being stupid, sorry.
So, Blood. A 50-episode animated series. It is held in an alternate universe telling of Blood, the Last Vampire. It has only minor connections and similarities to the film and many differences. Blood Plus premiered in Japan on October 8th, 2005 on MBS or TBS and aired until...
That's Japanese TBS, not yes. RTBS.
Yes. Until September 23rd, 2006 in the United States. The series was broadcast as a part of Cartoon Network's Adult Swim from March 11th, 2007 to March 23rd, 2008. The anime became its own franchise with two light novel series adaptations, three manga adaptations, and two video games. In 2011, Clamp and Production IG announced their collaboration of a 12-episode anime television series called Blood Sea. This spinoff is also set in a different universe from the film and the previous anime. Now I can see Dallas's predicament.
Yes. They're the same yet different.
Yes, there is. And also there was a sequel anime movie following up the last series. Blood Sea, The Last Dark, was released in theaters on June 2nd, 2012. The anime was also became its own franchise, two novelizations, a stage play, apparently, and three live-action films. This was a big franchise that no one's ever heard of.
I wouldn't say no one's ever heard of. It's just it's telling the same story over and over again. Yeah,
over and over.
Slightly differently. So it's ever got went far.
No.
Except it's a big anime name.
Yeah.
It got mishandled, I think.
Probably.
Instead of, like, it feels like, and I don't know the ins and outs of the other ones, but it feels like to me like they were like, too many hands in the mm-hmm. kitchen. They're like, I want to do my own spin. It's like everyone has their own version of Gumbo, and some people's is good, some people's not, and
it doesn't help that because there is not source material for this that was developed for, you know, because at least if like the manga or a light novel, there would have been places they could go and different stories in this to tell. Mm-hmm. This, they had one movie that they were basing everything on, and apparently they only knew how to make the one story just to keep expanding it.
Yes.
Well, from my understanding, they actually they paid somebody to create a light novel to go along with this movie to expound on the world a little
bit. It must have been like a one release thing, but not a whole series, but
It was a one-off just.
Yeah.
All right. So as I kind of alluded earlier, there was a live action film called Blood and the Last Vampire, which is basically a remake of the movie, expanding it a little bit more in 2009. An international co-production of France, Tokyo, Japan, or China, Japan, and the United States. This film is a live action adaptation of the film of the same of the anime, the film with the last name, the same name, created and produced by Studio Production IG. The film was released in Japan and other Asian markets on May 29th, 2009. It was released in the United Kingdom on June 26th on 2009, and saw a limited release in theaters in the United States starting on June 10th, 2009. Apparently, this film did very poorly in the box office. So that's all I have for you and info and stuff.
All right, getting into the summary. The story is set in 1966. Its main protagonist is a girl named Saya, who hunts bat-like vampiric creatures called Chiropterans. Saya is introduced on a subway train where she assassinates a man in a suit. Her American contacts or handlers arrive. One of them, David, begins to brief Saya on another mission, while the other, Lewis, discovers that the man Saya has just killed was probably not a Chiropteran. Saya's next mission begins at an American at the American Yokota Air Base, which is active in the buildup to the Vietnam War. At least one Chiropteran has managed to infiltrate the airbase, and it is only a matter of time before they feed again, go into hibernation, and become untraceable. Saya is to pose as a schoolgirl, infiltrate the high school adjacent to the base, and then track and kill the Chiropteran. At school, Saya runs into a meek nurse, Amino Makiho, on the eve of the school's annual Halloween party. Two of Saya's classmates, Sharon and Linda, make a visit to Makiho at the nurse's office. Suddenly, Saya bursts into the room, killing Linda and wounding Sharon, breaking her sword in the process. Both girls are revealed to be Chiropterans. Makiho goes into shock at the revelation. Meanwhile, a third Chiropteran reveals itself and begins making its way to the base. Back at the school, Makiho regains her nerve and pursues Sharon into a room full of dancing Americans in costume, where she finds Sharon transformed. Saya saves her, and both flee into the nearby motor pool. The Chiropterans trap them inside and attack David. David delivers a new sword, and Saya uses it to kill Sharon. The final Chiropteran then decides to flee, attempting to stow away on a departing cargo plane. David and Saya give chase, and she manages to strike the Chiropteran and mortally wound it. She then stands over the dying creature and lets some of her blood trickle into its mouth. Lewis arrives and recovers Makiho before the local police reach her. Afterward, Makiho is seen in an interview with government officials who question her about the night's events. However, it is revealed that all evidence of the battle between Saya and the Chiropterans has been covered up by both David, and Saya has disappeared, leaving Makiho with nothing to prove the veracity of her story. Her interviewer then asks her to identify Saya in a picture which has a girl that looks identical to her, except the picture was taken in 1892. The only other description of the picture is the word vampire. Makiho then returns to the school, where she narrates that she never really discovered the full truth behind Saya and the Chiropterans, and wonders if she's still out there fighting them. Getting into the trivia for this, there was originally supposed to be a three-episode OAV series, but due to the lack of time and money, only the middle segment was animated and given theatrical distribution. There is no separate English and Japanese soundtracks. 8 of the 11 main characters are voiced by English-speaking actors. The other 3 actors switch between Japanese and English depending on who they are talking to. And lastly, this is the first fully digitally animated film in Japan, from Japan. Mm-hmm. So, Dallas, what is your first like for this film?
My first like for the film, and I alluded to it earlier pretty hardcore, it's freaking beautiful. Mm-hmm. Like, it is gorgeous. I love the way that it's illustrated. I love the tones that they have when they do like the they simulate the golden hour. Golden hour is like this in photography terms. It's it's a time frame where the sun's just right. It's a great time to take pictures.
Yeah,
and they simulate that beautifully within this film. At the same time, that the coloring of it, it's got this weird mutedness of it where when the eerie parts are there, it's eerie. Like it's just like. Mm-hmm. The whole way they animated, just there's so much texture to the world that it's just beautiful to see.
Mm-hmm.
Like it felt like they really put a lot of work into going, this is what we can do. Please pay us more money.
Yeah.
So we can do more.
Yeah.
Jacob.
So bouncing off what Dallas just said, the animation, this is gorgeous. Oh my gosh, because they're gonna be like Drew said, be like, it looks like it's the middle of a story, and they're gonna, we don't have hardly any context what's going on, but what we do have is amazing animation and and like to how the how do you pronounce them?
Corrupted? I keep saying Corrupterin.
Corrupterin. Yeah, Corrupterin. You know,
vampire. I don't remember if that's how they pronounced it.
Yeah.
But it's incredibly similar to a word I had made up myself for a story idea that went nowhere.
Right.
Where my enemies were called Corrupterins because they were corrupted ones. And that's just now how it's in my head now. Every time I heard that word, it's like, oh, they used my word before I came up with the word myself.
Ah. Exactly.
Anyway,
like design wise, character wise, like this movie looks good. It is a beautifully well animated movie that has like Dallas just said, be like, it's more, hey, we're going to put our best foot forward. We're going to the brakes on everything in this. We're going to make this shine. Mm-hmm. Be like, just please give us more money to do it. And I'm sadly they never did. Mm-hmm. But I love the effort of animation they do in this film. And like you have gorgeous moments where the Corruptor transform, or at least the third one transforms. But overall, it's gorgeous film animation wise, just beautiful. So that's my first like. Drew?
My first like for this film is that, and I alluded to this earlier, this is a truly international production.
Uh huh.
Because, you know, in anime, if you're an anime fan, there's always been this debate among fans. Which version do you watch, the sub or the dub?
Dub.
And this is the only movie, the only anime out there that I am aware of, at least, in which that debate is useless because the sub and the dub are the same stinking movie. Mm-hmm. There is only one version of this film. If you're English or Japanese, you don't have to make this decision. It is... They are both. You hear both Japanese when it makes sense that for them to speak Japanese, and you hear English when it makes sense to hear English. And the couple of actors who are actually bilingual, or the characters are bilingual, when they switch to English, it does actually sound like how you expect a Japanese person to speak English words.
Can I just say,
it's that natural.
The girl that played Saya did amazing.
Yes, agree. Yes.
Playing both sides, like I was genuinely amazed when I realized what was happening here. Like,
yeah,
that woman, she knows how to act. To be able to act in two different languages is mind-boggling to me. I can barely act in English, but this lady's got it all going down. I'm like, holy crap.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, her English does have a bit of a broken English accent.
It does.
But it works. I don't care about that because naturally... She's speaking English, and it's obviously not her native language. Mm-hmm. So, of course, it's not going to be as natural as a native English speaker.
Right.
It works so stinking well.
It does.
I mean, sure, it threw me when I was first watching this, because I had no idea that there weren't two different... There wasn't two different language tracks. In the version I watched, I didn't have that choice. I just hit play.
It was against his will.
You said it.
This is against my will. Against my will, against my will, against my will, against my will. This is totally against my will!
Running gag that only me and Jacob get. Anyway. So, yeah, it's just done so well that it first threw me, I was like, okay, yeah, this is actually, why don't they do this more often when there's when you're Americans on screen? Because... some of these English in some of these animes is very bad. But here, it's natural. Mm-hmm. Most of it's because it's actually English people speaking it. Mm-hmm. But even the English spoken by the bilingual people is done well. So, mm-hmm. I love that there is no dub or sub in this. It is the movie. Mm-hmm. So you just sit and watch.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Dallas, what's your second like?
My second like is I like the concept of the movie.
Right.
And I'm saying that very specifically. The concept of the story is fascinating to me. And I genuinely, it left me wanting more of this world, if you will. I like vampires. I'm a fan of the genre of vampire stuff. Not all of it. Sometimes it's weird. I don't need my vampires to be sparkly.
No Twilight, thank you very much.
But the lore, it's always been one of those things I liked as a kid. And I appreciate what they did with this, you know, this vampire girl that for some reason she can't hurt humans and she's going after these creatures that maybe or may not be some sort of form of vampire. It was an interesting world, and she's working with the United States government, and she's going into these strange places. And then to have it time-locked within the 1960s around the Vietnam War, that was fascinating. Mm-hmm. I really wanted more of this to take place in this film. And so, again, that's what I'm saying. Like, I genuinely like the concept of the story itself.
My second like of this film, again, kind of bouncing off Drew's first, the language duality of it, because you'd be like, I'd never heard of this before. Be like, again, the review I saw, it was like, okay, it's one of those very rare movies that's done English and Japanese at the exact same time, and it's like, oh, that's interesting. Again, be like, you give props to, like, okay, you're doing something different. Mm-hmm. You're doing something inventive. And it's like, okay, yeah. So you're getting, you're
taking
people
a very big risk.
Yeah, exactly, huge risk with that. And be like, you're like Dallas said, the fact to be like, you have these actresses and actors who are speaking English and Japanese and doing a phenomenal job, definitely of what is her name? Saya?
Saya.
Mm-hmm. Saya. Yeah, does a phenomenal job with doing the English and Japanese. And it's just beautifully well done. Be like, again, I think of the nurse, be like, when she breaks into English, it's not a very good performance of it, but there again, that's not her original language. Mm-hmm. And so it's done, I'd be like, it's giving off a authentic performance of someone who doesn't speak English as their first language. And so again, taking a big risk with a film, and I thought that was very bold of them to do, is a dual language movie. And for someone like me, I first time I watched it, I was like, wait, this is supposed to be in English. Why are they speaking Japanese? Be like, oh, crap. There's no subtitles. Where's the subtitles? I'm going to get lost. But again, beautiful film animation-wise. And the fact that they took the boldness and the it's definitely the boldness to do a duality, a language duality film. And I was like, wow, that's impressive. So, yeah. Two languages. Wah! Same movie. Drew?
My second like for this film is the action.
Yes.
It is all of the sword fight, her sword fights against the Corruptorans is like spot on. Is it bloody? Yes. Is it gory?
So bloody.
Yes. Does that make me squeamish? Somehow, no. I don't know why. It's because I don't get squeamish when I'm watching something, like, unless it's like right in front of me and it's real.
Right.
But I watch this going, oh man, this is spot on. This is 2000. Because granted, I'm used to 2000s anime still being, you know, a little. I'm so used to TV quality. Mm-hmm. I'll say. So I was like, I'm watching this and going, oh man, this is great action. She's even the part where she hits the Corruptoran with the fake sword, not realizing it's fake.
Yes.
It's like, oh, that is funny. And I'm sitting there going, you say it's a fake sword. Is it aluminum? Is it like plastic? And if it is plastic,
wall hanger.
If it, it's a wall hanger. But, I mean, If it is, then how did you not know it before you got into the fight with the thing? Mm-hmm. Because a real sword is going to be heavier than a fake one.
Yes. Oh, my gosh.
But I'll just go with she was distracted at the time, and she just said, ooh, it's Kitsana. I like Kitsanas.
Ooh, it run across pretty. Town. That'll kill something.
Yeah. At the antique shop that was not an antique shop.
No.
Right.
At the scam shop. So.
Yes.
Yeah. But the action in this is like so spot on.
Agreed.
That when the Crocodile started transforming into its flight form, I was like, oh, that's disturbing, but in a fun way. Yeah. And then takes off. It's like, okay. There's my there is a good teaser for the Man Bat at the very beginning of Batman the Animated
Series.
Yes, because that's looking like that's going to be their new TAS.
Right.
So, it's just so good. It's just the action is just so good in this. But now that we're done talking about what we liked about this, we need to talk.
No, we're still in our second.
Yeah, my second. I was the last one.
Okay, never mind. I was like, "Whoa, wait a minute."
We've all done our twos.
I know
we don't do threes on guest shows.
That's right. Never mind.
You forgot this.
I forgot. Oh my gosh!
After we discussed it.
Yeah, you forget. It's a long week. See, my apologies.
This is what I get for not including you with the chat with Dallas.
Yeah, that might have been helpful, Drew.
My bad.
Anyway, watch the right movie.
Broken Sword. That's all I gotta say. Broken
Sword
scene.
Broken Sword. Dislikes. Dallas, what's your first dislike for this film?
Okay. Bouncing off of my liking the concept of the movie, I didn't like how disjointed the entirety of it felt. And how things just kind of happen. You're like, why are we here? How did we get here? There's a lot of things that were left unspoken as far as motives and things taking place. And I'm like, it left me wanting more of the world, which is great, but there was a lot that took place. I was just like, what is even taking place here? And it felt like Jacob in the pre-show had mentioned that somebody had mentioned that like this felt like a demo reel. Uh-huh. And it does at times. It's like the fight with the Crocton in the ball. First off, beautiful scene, gorgeously animated. And that was a funny moment where she smacked the guy thing and the sword's all mangled. But they didn't play it as a joke. They were just like, oh, and then kicked her out of the way. There was no like intentionality of it. It was just there.
Yeah.
And that was kind of frustrating to me that there were just so many things that just the world wasn't fleshed out.
Yeah.
And again, I get it. It was supposed to be an OAV and they shrunk it down into a 45-minute short. But I don't know. It was just frustrating to not have more of what this could be. And then on the back end, knowing what they have done later with the series, with the remake movie, I'm like, man, why, you know, somebody spot him $50 to do a few more scenes or something. I don't know. But it's just frustrating that things were left open.
Jacob?
Agreed. So I'm going to call my first, dislike. Beautifully unexplained. So let me explain. So you have this film, which is this OVA, the very, very short film, 45 minutes. We're giving no explanation of what's really going on. We're like Dallas would be like, we're set up with situations. There's conclusions. Like, for example, like the one big conclusion be like Saya sees the sword, then it comes back into play later. Then everything else is like, okay, kind of be like, okay, let's do this and this and this. But there's no beginning and there's no end. It's literally, oh, we're on this train. Chop. Be like, oh, you killed a dude. Hey, let's go to the school. This and this. Corruptorate. Oh, big scary thing. Oh, big fight. Movie over. And no explanation what's going on, except for we know Saya is the last of them. The last, what was it? The last one, the original. Only one left. The original.
The only original left, whatever that means.
Yeah, whatever that means. Does that mean she's an actual vampire? Is she half vampire? We don't know. And like, there's so many.
Is she a daywalker? Could she hang out with Blade?
Yeah. That'd be kind of cool. But
do they try to ice skate uphill? I'm sorry.
You blood-sucking fools.
I went to Blade for some reason. Of course, I'm sorry.
It's a good movie.
Actually, yeah, I've seen it once. I didn't watch Blade until recently.
Wow, that's such a that's an iconic movie.
It's so good. I watched it on bootleg. What's wrong with you, Drew? Come on, man.
What's wrong with me is it's one of those films that I obviously was not allowed to watch when it came out for obvious reasons.
That's fair.
And this was on my backlog for a long time. Same reason I just I only recently got around to watching Howard the Duck.
Oh. Ooh.
I remember watching it as a kid. That was weird. That's a weird movie.
Let's not talk about that.
No. That was scarring as a child.
Yes. Oh my gosh.
Let's not talk about that.
Now.
Speaking of scars, so Tropton didn't get scarred at all.
Yes. Back to what Jacob was talking about.
What was it about? Oh yeah, that's right.
Vampires.
Vampires.
If these are vampires.
Yeah, if these are vampires, the story again, be like Drew said before, this is literally the middle of a story that we don't have any front context or rear context. It's literally you took the middle of, let's see, the X-Men movie came in the, what was the first one came out in what, 2000? 2000, 2001.
Basically, it's watching X2 without having seen X-Men 1.
Exactly. So you have no idea what's going on. It's like, oh, I like this guy with claws. Ooh, this guy can bamf. That's like, what's going on? I'd be like, I have no idea, but it's pretty to watch.
Better yet,
I have no idea what's going on.
Better yet, it's like going into Civil War and not having seen any other Marvel movie ever made.
Oh, yeah. That's probably the most accurate way of putting that. Yes, absolutely. It's like, here's a better one. Here's what, and actually, I have no person who did this. So be like, you go, I think, Endgame was in theaters. So
that would be even worse.
So a coworker of mine who was like 16, 17 years old. He's like, a bunch of friends are going to see the movie. It's okay, cool. She goes in the movie. She's never seen anything MCU. Anything.
Oh, wow.
Like, she knows who Iron Man is. She knows who Captain America is. But she knows who Spider-Man is. She's like, I have no idea what's going on.
Of course you don't.
So it's like this.
It's the second part of a two-part movie that's concluding a 10-year-long storyline.
Exactly.
Exactly.
How would you know what you're doing? This is beautifully made.
Yeah.
And that's all this movie is like, there's obviously something that happened before where they would establish all this stuff, or they're planning to establish it later. But they never got around to doing that.
Never did.
Which brings me to my first dislike. This is obviously a pilot for a show that never got made.
Word.
That is how this actually feels. If this was the first episode, you know, maybe an elongated episode, admittedly, like some of the animes do now, where your first episode is an hour long with commercials. Yes. This was meant to introduce you to the world, and then as the show got on, we would explain what the Corruptorans are, who Saya is, exactly. All this other stuff. And after about 12 episodes, you'd have a better idea, and then they'd be praying for season two.
Uh huh.
This is modern anime, because why would we get a 24-episode season anymore? But yeah, that's what this feels like, because it feels like we're introducing all this stuff to you, we're laying pipe, we're laying story threads, and then they never pick them up anywhere again.
Right.
There were sequels that were alternate universe retellings of this film that expanded on it, but I don't want an expansion, a alternate universe expansion on this. I want you to me an actual sequel that is actually what the next couple episodes of this show would be like.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I want. Right. But so yeah, the fact that this is just a 45-minute, what feels like first episode of a TV series, is my first dislike. It's like, you could have done so much more with this if you'd have just made episode two.
Right.
Dallas, what's your second dislike?
Before I go to my second dislike, if I could add to yours. If they had just, like, we talked about, this is 45 minutes long. That's how long this thing was.
Mm-hmm.
I genuinely think if they just had 15 more minutes of exposition somehow
Agreed. In there. Agreed.
Just
some
minutes,
story bits. Let scenes breathe.
It would have made
sprinkle here,
the world
there.
Of difference in this film. Mm-hmm. I get they didn't have a lot of funds, a lot of money, but it was just so choppy all the way through.
They could do like Evangelion did and have a long scene where it's just a camera pan and one little mouth animating to explain what's going on.
Exactly, exactly.
Pull an Ava.
Pull an Ava.
I do also want to say, earlier we mentioned how it felt like JoJo's Bizarre Adventures. The guy who directed this did direct JoJo's Bizarre Adventures after doing this.
Okay, the series then, not the OVA?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, cool.
So that was a thing.
I can see that now you say that.
Yeah, so my next dislike as far as this show goes is the way it ended.
Yes.
Again, this is part of that choppiness of it. They spent all this time, they're like, quick, get the nurse. And then they cut away, and the nurse, they've dealt with the nurse, but we don't know what she's did because she's down with what's clearly a separate government agency.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Handlers.
Interviewing. And I'm saying that's separate because if it wasn't separate, they wouldn't be interviewing her, asking her what she saw, and if it, showing her a picture of Saya back in the 1800s. Like, so clearly this is a different government agency trying to track her down. And yet, like, what was the point of grabbing? Like, what were they going to do with her? Like, why? Like, why did you make a big ordeal about it? Like, we got to get her before the authorities do. Like, what did you do?
Yeah.
And then she has, like, these moments where she's, like, kind of freaking out and nothing happens. Mm-hmm. Like, it's just, she's like, all right, back to my job in PTSD.
Uh-huh.
Yay. It was just kind of disappointing. You had all this taking place and, again, some of it's a product of the, we just need some more exposition. 15 yeah. minutes.
Agreed.
You know, explain that last drop zone, he's trying to get to that plane to fly off to Vietnam and start a colony there. And let it get away so you have a reason for him to be in Vietnam in the series or whatever they want to do. Because they made the big deal about say
going to Vietnam. It's going to try and get to the mainland where it can cause more damage.
Yeah, exactly.
Because at least in Japan, it was isolated.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. But then the movie, I'm using quotation marks for movie, they say that they're going, that's everything's picking up in Vietnam. Why? Like, there's no connector point going to Vietnam other than it's the Vietnam War.
Yeah.
But I'm like, do something here, guys. Like, it was just,
there are parts, that whole Vietnam War connection feels like it was tacked on in the last month of the production.
Mm-hmm. Agreed.
Right. But anyway.
So that's my dislike. It's just the ending was kind of lackluster. I wanted more. Granted, the entirety of the show has this very calm, very chill beat to it. The silent moments are great. I actually enjoy the silence of some of it. The series was like that too at times.
Mm.
But they needed just to end that better.
Mm-hmm. All right, so my second and final dislike for this movie is the vampire part of the film. So the title of this movie is Blood, the Last Vampire. We're never given an explanation like the I want to say Chiroptereids.
Close enough.
Chiroptereids, whatever they're called, and be like
Batman.
Batman. Blah 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 blah. I am Night. I am Vengeance.
They called them demons.
Huh?
They called them demons.
At one point. I agree. So our we get introduced to these demon characters who kind of look like bats. And then we had Saya, who we don't get any explanation who she is. Or what she is. We get that she doesn't like the name of the Lord being provoked in front of her. Like, mm-hmm. she wants it silenced.
Yeah.
Like, she has a fear of the Lord's name.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like, you know, what Jesus, like, he goes into the house or goes into the...
subway.
Oh. Yeah. Hmm? What?
Jesus went into a subway?
What?
Oh, sorry.
I heard him say Jesus in the Dallas set subway. I go, wow, this is a new scripture.
Eat fresh.
This is a new scripture vampire. I hadn't heard about.
Vampire sandwich.
Zombies eat brains.
Gosh. No, but what I'm referring to is Jesus goes meets Legion in the cemetery.
Oh yeah,
and and he literally casts the demons out, and they go out into the pigs, and the pigs fall off the cliff and drown. Am I saying that right?
Technically, yes.
Technically, yes. Okay, good.
You're there.
Yeah, very simple.
It was a good paraphrase.
Yeah, it's a bit paraphrased. I always paraphrase everything. But be like, we're given this notion that the movie is about vampires, but we really don't get any explanation to be like what the Chiroptereids are, what Saya is at all, be like, we, you know, be like, oh, we can sense things. And there's really no vampire-ish. Be like, we don't get the sense of Dracula or Van Helsing or Nosferatu or something like that. The only thing we're given that this film is about a vampire is at the last freaking minute of this film where it's like, oh, Saya from the 1800s, and it says vampire on it. That's it. I'm like, could you make it more about vampires instead of about demons?
So well, technically,
vampires are demons. If we're going by that technical term, they are demons. But be like, at least make it a vampire movie, not about just, you say it's a vampire movie, but it's not about vampires.
Admittedly, this is an original, a series of original monsters that are similar enough to vampires. They put vampire in the title. Because they don't they don't know if it's a vampire or not. The people who wrote vampire on the picture,
apparently,
right.
So,
but the implication
is he could just be immortal.
I can take it.
Demons.
I can take it that this is not a Dracula-esque vampire, and this is just a vampire-like creature.
Yeah.
That, I mean, thankfully, it's not Twilight vampires.
Oh, thank the Lord.
Thankfully,
yeah.
But I mean, it's
at least.
I could see how maybe these were the quote-unquote vampires that the vampire legend was based on. Like, maybe it was maybe this is what the urban legend is based on, this kind of the idea. Maybe right. That's the route they went with it. But yeah, I get it that the fact that they are not vampires the way we traditionally think is a bit annoying, especially since I'm watching it and going, so she's walking around in sunlight and not dying.
Mm-hmm.
They took a picture of her in the
1800s. Yes.
Yeah.
Back when silver was definitely still used in the emulsion.
She definitely
knew should. If all those people were vampires, it should be a blank picture of a house.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. When
Count Dracula is more of a vampire than this.
Hey, like I said, I could see this as maybe this is what the vampire legend is actually based on, and what we know of that comes apart with Dracula and all this other stuff. Mm. Is like what Disney would do with Cinderella and all the other ones where, you know, the fairy tales are actually a lot darker than the version we have that we all know from Disney. I could see maybe if that was it, but it's like, I'm agreeing with you. And this is actually kind of my second dislike is I see the words, the last vampire. I'm expecting to see Dracula-esque vampires.
Mm-hmm.
The tradition, I know these weren't as popular. I don't know if these were popular in Japan. I could be wrong. But it's like, I'm expecting that kind of vampire, and the fact that it's two beasts that inhabit two different parts of the vampire lore, I can kind of work with. But since it's like, no, these are original monsters that you'd called a vampire.
Mm-hmm.
And to the point where the actual bad versions of them, you gave an entirely different name to. It's Corruptorans, which does sound like a name I came up with for a monster I made in high school. So, yeah, congratulations. You stole a high school kid name for a monster. It's not that it's a bad film. If you'd have not made the vampire connection, I wouldn't care. But you called it vampire. You set expectations. You were obviously planning to release this internationally, so you ought to think how vampire comes across. It's like, I don't know, maybe it's just because I'm seeing it after the fact, and I just heard, and I didn't see a trailer for this. I didn't see a commercial for this. All I knew was, we're watching this movie, and then I went straight into it. The fact, it's not, I actually would call this more of a nitpick than anything else.
Mm.
But the fact that it's not traditional vampires is just disappointing.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I feel you on that. And again, it's just like, just give me 15 minutes to tell me how there's a vampire situation here. And I did some digging into it, and like,
also,
like,
what was
Wikipedia?
What was the deal with her dripping her blood into the Corruptor's mouth at the end?
Yeah, that was the same thing. It's like, what in the world? Again, in the middle of the story, we're not giving any context.
I was half expecting the Corruptor to get back up and be healed and not be evil anymore.
Yeah, turn back into whatever it was beforehand.
Right? I mean, something at least. But now I did see, like, in a Wikipedia, like, even Wikipedia is confused about a lot of what's happening here.
Oh, yeah.
But they call the Coroptians vampiric-like creatures.
Mm.
And in the manga, and I did a quick skim of the manga, and it's pretty intense and racy. But apparently she's kind of, like, they hint that she's half-human, half-vampire.
Okay, so she's a daywalker. I can live with this.
She's literally
kind of bladish.
Yeah.
You know,
but it's not as cool.
But give us something in the movie to know that.
Exactly. I mean, it tells you nothing.
Yeah.
She could just be superpowered human for all I really know.
Or just immortal.
Because she does not exhibit any vampire traits.
No.
At all.
Yeah, no. Be like she has no superhuman strength.
At best, she's a gothic schoolgirl with a sword.
That's probably your best explanation.
That's the closest we get to anything.
It's like, oh, right. I'm just an emo, and I just want to hit something really, really hard. Nothing against emos.
Or goths.
Or goths.
Or scenes, or whatever the term is now for that group. I know those are all technically different things. Don't kill me.
Send your hate mail to Drew at the Cellcast.
That's a good thing that email address doesn't actually exist.
Oh, they'll find a way, Drew.
So I mean, don't
just listen to the credits. You'll find our email address.
Yes, exactly.
That nobody ever uses.
Hey, don't give people ideas. Then they'll send us all kinds of weird emails, which I don't
read. At this point, I would take weird emails over. By the way, your email address is, since it's registered for this thing, you're now eligible for, no, I'm not eligible. I'm a podcast, not a person. I don't need that spam filter. Why are you letting this through?
Stop emailing me, Trent, about your Podchaser junk. No.
Actually, that's fine too, but I just ignore it. So.
Oh my gosh.
What do you mean there are hot singles in my area?
Oh. Ooh la la.
They don't talk to me. I know that.
Awkward moments with Drew.
I'm the only one on this show not married right now, so let's just leave it at that.
So, but yeah. So not vampires.
Yeah, not vampires.
I would still put them above Twilight vampires, though.
Oh, you're not kidding.
I just want explanations.
It's like Edward Quinn just pulling this woman along, dude. Just be like, he's like one of the worst dudes ever, and he's a vampire. Just saying. I read two and a half books. I had to shut the third book down. I was like, I'm not reading this anymore. Bella, you're an idiot. Bye.
Obviously, he's the worst vampire because it took him 20 years to turn into a Batman.
That
true story.
Womp womp true womp.
Story. But boy, however was many he years cool it Batman, was. Though.
Yeah, the Batman was pretty good. I agree. It was a good long movie. Has anybody seen the main one?
Huh? Yeah.
Oh, how was it?
I'm enjoying it.
You know, the
movie. It's an ongoing series.
Oh, okay, cool.
Mm-hmm. I've watched like two episodes of the series.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yep.
So back in story about not vampires.
Other Batman.
Other Batman. I'm not Batman.
I know we've gone through all of our
we're about to hit ratings.
Can we talk about real quick the teachers or the nurse's face?
Oh my god.
she runs around the corner and then screams for like 20 seconds straight.
Good night. You're giving what's her name from Halloween a run for money.
Oh, Jamie Lee Curtis.
Jamie Lee Curtis, yeah. You're giving Jamie Lee Curtis a run for her money for Scream Queen.
And then when Saya punches the one guard in the stomach, and she's just like, oh,
yeah.
Like she's just standing at it, like, what is happening? I'm like, lady, you have been gone through so much tonight. That should be the least of your worries.
Like, here, it'd be like, here's a tea, and here's a Bible. Read, please.
Just don't let Saya see it. She'll get angry.
Yeah. You have a cross? Oh, my gosh.
Dude, the second I saw she had a cross necklace, I was going, I wonder if Saya's going to notice that. Because she's not going to be happy. For whatever reason.
But why? Why is she not happy? Give me an explanation.
We don't know. I would have loved it if maybe there had been... Like, maybe it's not just, Christian iconography. What if it was, like, all religious iconography? Mm-hmm. That would have been cool, but we don't even get to see that.
No, it's all Christian iconography. Mm-hmm. Be like the one guy, he provokes he provokes Jesus' name, and she literally just grabs him by the throat, grabs him by the face.
It's like, why?
And the nurse is more like, oh, I'm going to pray because I'm scared. And Saya just not having it. And like, okay. I think there's a time to come to Jesus moment here.
Or
at least an exorcist.
That is like the one actual vampire trait that is in this film. Uh-huh. Is that she doesn't like Jesus.
No.
Right.
Doesn't like Christianity.
Yeah, do not provoke the Lord.
But she can grab a necklace and not die. So
Yeah, no burning, no nothing. So what is she?
What is going on?
I think she's just immortal and just has a very atheistic view towards Christianity. I've lived for thousands of years. I'm just tired of these Christians. And I'm not strong. I don't have any special powers. I'm just being like, if someone just said, I'm a vampire.
Considering from what I understand of how this thing was generated, the entire concept was Japanese schoolgirl with a sword. Go.
Yeah. Sounds about right.
It's like, okay, that's really all the thought you put into this.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, basically.
Anyway,
yes.
We need to rate this film.
Yes.
Dallas, what is your rating for this film?
Remind me what my scale is to work with.
0 to 10, rounded to the nearest 0.5, where 10 is the highest.
Gosh, guys, this is hard because it's pretty. Like, it's a beautiful film. I'm going to give it a 7.
Okay.
Just, again, I'll try to find the DVD now and own it because I don't have it now. I'm a completionist, but
I bet it's $300 on eBay.
Oh, I'm probably not surprised.
Probably is. And so some dude, but is it worth watching on a regular basis? No, but probably it's not.
It's a good Halloween film.
Yeah, it's quick. It's easy. Pop it in the background. It's genuinely beautiful. I really appreciate the art. There's scenes that I would love to like see cut out and used for like art in other places. So that's what I'm going to give it.
Jacob? So just to let you know, Dallas, you can pick it up on eBay for $11.32 with free shipping.
Wow.
$11.32.
Yeah, not bad.
Wow. That's not bad at all.
No, it's not.
There must be a backlog of it somewhere.
Probably.
It's the old, they found it in the old Hastings warehouse.
Yes. Oh my God.
In Amarillo.
Yes. Amarillo by morning, and then I'll be a dead vampire.
Jacob, what are you rating this film? All right,
so my score for this film is a 7. Be like the same way with Dallas. The animation is gorgeous. Like, it's like they put their entire front foot forward with this project, and just because there again, it's the middle of a project, and we just thought, okay, this got all the action in it. This, we're gonna give you no context, but we're gonna show you something really shiny and pretty. Please give us money. You know, like, it's a beautiful demo, which I wish they would have made into a full feature or an OVA. That would have been great, but we don't have that. And be like, again, I wish we had all the context of what was going on. Be like, because it says blood, the last vampire, when there's no vampires in sight, except for demons that kind of are similar to vampires.
Vampire-ish. It's still more of a vampire than
I want to be a vampire. Blah. But overall, be like, yeah, I think it's good. It's like, yeah, if you want a copy, you can go track it down on eBay or find it in a used bookstore or movie store or whatever. If you find that, let us know where it is.
Go to Half Price. I'm sure there might be a copy there.
Maybe.
It is $40 on Amazon for the Blu-ray.
Oh.
Ooh, the Blu-ray.
Ooh. Anyways, be like, yeah, so 7.0 for me. How about you, Drew?
I'm going to give it a 7.5 just because the animation is that good, and I respect them for it being a dual language film this way. Unfortunately, though, there's just not much story to hang your hat on in this.
Agreed.
It's like just barely enough story there to give you context for the fights.
Yes.
It's not enough to give to like really like sink your teeth into. Pardon the pun. So, yeah, I'm giving it a 7.5.
Ah.
Which brings us not just to the end of our review of Blood the Last Vampire, mm-hmm. but also the end of Halloween month, which means next week
it's Ghibli.
It's Studio Ghibli month. And we are coming, starting up with From Up on Poppy Hill, a movie I've not seen. But I have it right over there.
Ah.
Because, fun fact, my Studio Ghibli collection is complete.
Wow.
Oh, yeah, Boy and the Heron.
I'm looking at it right. Hey!
Not you.
Thanks.
That would be the dog and the heron.
Again, Drew said it, I didn't.
I'll pay for it Sunday.
Exactly.
Hey, if I can give you a Studio Ghibli connection to this film, Kenji Kamiai, who helped write this film we just did, he just lost it. But he helped actually work on one of the Ghibli movies. He was a background artist.
Oh, cool.
One of them.
Okay, so there's a little connection here.
Yeah,
well,
so that's a little segue.
With the Ghibli films, there's like always some connection to everything because, like, Studio Ghibli actually does a lot of back end work too for like a lot of different movies, and a lot of other companies do work for Ghibli when a Ghibli movie is coming out. Because why would you not want to get involved with a Miyazaki film?
That is true,
right?
Or connected to Miyazaki film. But that's fair. We'll be starting with From Up on Poppy Hill next week. And next week is also the end of our coverage for Spy Family Season 2. Oh. And we have to take a small break from Spy Family because Season 3 is not out yet.
Yes.
But we will be looking forward to that. For now, we're just going to do some intermission. When we get back, we will actually talk about some Spy Family.
So I wanted to break in really, really fast. Breaks. Really quick. Because they're going to be like, if most people know that Star Trek Lower Decks Season 5 is out now, or at least episode 1.
The first two episodes are out.
First two episodes are out now, and we're going to start reviewing those part of our Plus, our TAS Plus episode for us on a different feed. On a different feed?
Am I saying no. It's coming out to the main feed.
Oh, it's coming out to the main
feed. But it's going to come out like on Tuesday.
Oh, okay.
So Wednesday.
Oh, yeah. So look for that when it comes out.
It'll be a separate episode on the main feed, so keep an eye for that.
So, yeah.
I was going to save that for TAS, but whatever.
Whatever.
This podcast is a proud member of Culture Box. Whether you enjoy geeky reviews, comedy, or original fiction, you can open up the Culture Box and find something excellent for your soul. Point your web browser to culturebox.media.
This week, we're just checking out Geek Devotions. Geek Devotions is a collaboration of devoted geeks that are devoted to letting people know that they are loved. They produce a weekly geek culture-infused devotional, their podcast ComTalk, and written articles, along with, like, what, seven other podcasts now? Is that right, Dallas? It seems like seven.
No comment, for legal reasons.
But they are all presented in a unique and dynamic way. I'm sorry, I just jumped to the wrong one. Backing up. They're all designed to encourage and challenge people in the geek community, bridging the gap between their faith and their geekdoms. You can find all of their content at geekdevotions.com. The Cellcast would also like to thank the following patrons: Ashley and Francisco Ruiz, PaulGPowers.com, The Monster Island Film Vault,
Roar,
and Edwin Gonzalez.
Yay!
If you would like to have your name shouted out on the show, some special art from Jacob.
I'm working on it.
Uncut episodes, plus for an additional $5, for a total of $10, you can force us to watch and review something within reason. And if you wanted to do that, just donate. Go donate to us on Patreon.com. Also, Go to our show notes, click our Redbubble store, or the link to our Redbubble store, and go buy t-shirts. The Halloween 2024 of Gigi in a Stitch costume sitting on a pumpkin. You have until October 31st to purchase this shirt. Otherwise, it's disappearing until next October. So go buy your t-shirt. You can find the links to our store, plus the Patreon, plus the Culture Box, over in our show notes. My brain just died right there in the middle of that.
Plus, new designs coming out really fast. Or really soon.
Borf. James Bond Jr.
Impossible. Call me Big Man if you want to reach me. When you want to page me, it's okay.
The Man of Flintstone.
What an agent, what a squirrel. He's got the country in a whirl. What's his name?
Shh, secret squirrel.
Johnny Quest.
Anybody want a peanut?
Still love that.
Episode mission 34, The Hand That Connects to the Future. Originally aired December 2nd, 2023, it adapts chapters 54 and 55 of the manga and is still part of the Cruise Adventure arc. Ladies and gentlemen, we are finishing the Cruise Adventure arc this evening.
Go sailing away.
In this episode, Lloyd leaves Anya at the daycare in a hurry and then disguises himself as a state security service member to take care of a bomb on the ship. Getting into the trivia... There's a number of, as is the case with every single one of these episodes, there's a number of anime-exclusive content. The episode shows how Anya ran away from the daycare lady, while in the manga, Anya just simply leaves right away after Lloyd leaves her there. Meanwhile, the anime shows Anya playing with a ball for a minute before telling the lady at the daycare that she is bored and wants to draw, which Anya uses as a distraction to leave. When Matthew, the director, allows Yor to return to her family and leaves, she is additionally shown running after him across the deck. And at the end of the episode, the Forgers wake up in their cabins the morning after the events of Chapter 55 and watch the ship approach the resort island. Mm. And that's all I got for trivia for this episode. What are our thoughts on this? Dallas, why don't you start?
Yeah, so legitimately, Lloyd handling all the bombs.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And the revelation, like, oh, there's more bombs here everywhere.
Oh, no.
They're having I was actually pretty suspenseful. Like, it was
agreed.
As like loving and like, ah, this is a sweet little bit. Like, it's like, holy crap, they're gonna die. And then, like, just.
And Lloyd just over exaggerating everything. It's, oh my gosh. It's like, oh my gosh.
It's like,
poor Anya. It's like, oh my gosh. It's great. Go ahead.
Oh my God. It's great. And then one thing I absolutely loved was when the portion where Anya is about to, she finds yours little. Thorn dagger thing.
Oh yeah, I love that.
She's like, I must show it to Mama. But what I loved about it was the way that she threw it was actually the throwing stance that Yor had taught her.
Earlier
in the season, and I thought that was
during the dodgeball
really,
arc.
Yes,
that was such a great callback.
Uh-huh. I didn't realize that.
And this is her daughter.
They even did the glowing effect on the knife, like they did with the volleyball.
Yes,
and it just. Gets up there.
Thunk, thunk, thunk.
And I'm watching that going, so is Anya also secretly telekinetic and she doesn't know it? And her wishes to get it over there is the only reason it got over there and landed in just the right spot for the guy to step on it, let it slide out from underneath him so he falls on his stomach,
right.
and then it stabs him in the butt. Just the right spot so that Yor can actually see it, so she can take care of business in a minute with the other guy. It's like, awfully convenient. I don't care.
Yes,
and then I know, so like, just as I planned.
Yes,
exactly. My plan worked perfectly. It's like, right, Anya.
Sure, Anya. Sure, it did.
Yeah.
So, granted, Anya's plans have done a lot better this season than they did for season.
That is true. Oh, my gosh. Season one. Oh, my gosh. He's like, I'm going to do this and this and this. And it just fails miserably. It's like, I failed. I'm a miserable failure.
Her failures come back later.
Yes, they do.
Yeah. Trust me. I've seen Code White.
No spoilers.
I'm not spoiling anything.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Just... look out for that chocolate bonbon. That's all.
Chocolate bonbon.
It's That's all I'm saying.
I feel like the guy out of context here.
You will find out in December.
Thank you.
Yeah, there's a spoiler alert for you.
You're the only one not wearing the Cellcast shirt. You're also out of context with the anime.
True.
For those of you who don't know this, because I think it's everybody, our first episode in December is actually Spy Family Code White.
Yes. That's going to be good.
So keep an eye out for that if you're enjoying our Spy Family coverage.
My wife is going to be so confused.
That'll happen when she meets the god of poop.
Again, context.
That scene.
You're not helping.
I killed Dallas.
I killed Dallas. Dallas is out.
That whole scene. Sorry, we're not talking about that.
Thank you.
No, we're not talking about that. No, we're talking about the cruise ship, which is almost as very, which is not the same story, but
anyway,
it aired the same time the movie came out.
Okay.
Yeah, it did. But yeah, so like I said, the whole thing, I appreciate. Unlike the last film we watched, we talked about, it felt climatic at the end of the story. And there was closure, and I knew what was happening.
I'm trying to think. The last one you were on was Long Halloween, wasn't it?
It was this thing called Blood, the Last Vampire.
The movie. Gotcha. I was thinking previous episodes, yes. Not previously on this episode.
There's so many good episodes we've had with Dallas, and it's like, wait, which one was it?
It's the one where we were at in the Shadow Realm.
What happened to this?
Legitimately, though, like that's one of the things I love about the series as a whole is that there's a lot of cute little small moments and it's very slice of life. But when it gets into these arcs right here, like it's a complete story. It's satisfying to end.
Agreed.
I mean, the arcs are the stuff I really enjoy just because it feels like there's full complete stories. Yeah. I'm not a real big fan of the onesie twosie episodes, standalone ones, but at least they are pushing characterization along. So
yeah.
But yeah, this cruise ship arc is so far my favorite one, just because we finally are getting her own story.
Oh yeah, I love this.
Where yours the focus and not Lloyd. In fact, Lloyd's just doing his best.
Yeah, he's a background character.
To keep Anya entertained.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And Anya's the bridge between, because she knows what's going on. Be like, she's keeping the audience informed what's going on, and the fact be like she's trying to keep everybody away from each other for this family can stay united. And the one thing I love about this entire story arc is the fact that we get more like we all said, but at the same time we get these moments of crisis. What is her purpose? Why does she do what she does? Be like, and you know, what if everything falls apart? What if she dies? And be like, everything is left to ruin. And like, she finds her purpose. She finds it's not a mission because she cares about these two. She loves Anya, and I think she's starting to fall in love with Twilight.
Lloyd.
Thank you. I always forget his name. I always think Twilight, but
I think of him as Twilight most of the time too.
There we go. Yeah, Lloyd. And so you get this bonding of a family, and definitely in the next episode, but this episode in particular, you have she does find her inner strength to finish the job, and at the exact same time, you have this bomb threat that's going on, and here's the thing: we find in this episode, we find that Anya's powers are more effective than they have been before, because at this
point, that's because it's not a full moon.
What?
Remember that from the previous episodes, where her powers go away when it's a full moon?
Oh, that's right.
Or was it a new moon?
It was a new moon.
New moon. Sorry.
Yeah, new moon. That's right.
Which is not a full moon.
Yeah.
Yes, it's the opposite of a full moon.
Something like that.
Unlike you, who become more powerful,
Jacob, exactly,
than a full moon, you become the world's greatest podcaster ever.
So,
anyways,
a couple things before we cut off this episode.
Yes,
We do need to talk about the last bomb that Lloyd's able to defuse the fun way of throwing it into the ocean.
Yeah,
on top of the guys who are trying, the last two guys who are trying to escape
and trying to kill each other,
the bomb in the first place.
No, I'm gonna take you out. And boom, you take each other out.
Yes, and you get your on the other side of the street going, I could have sworn I just heard a bomb go off.
Did that scene just feel like so much like Acme and Entertainment right there?
Yes,
like,
it did. Yes, it did. Oh my gosh.
It's like I half expected like Elmer Fudd and Wile E. Coyote down there, and then just
yeah.
Yes.
And the last thing I want to touch on is the customer's farewell to Yor with the hug, especially the hug with little Graham.
Oh yeah, like, bittersweet.
Yeah, where Yor is like, but I'm all bloody. I don't want to get blood on him. And she said, you know, these hands have got blood on him. He says, because of your hands, Graham will get to live after tonight. It's like, okay, yeah, that's it's that why you do what you do sort of a thing. Even though there's obviously she wants to, she's I just that thought that was a beautiful moment in this episode.
Yeah, agreed.
A good capstone is Yor hugging the little boy, Graham.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
Y'all ready to jump into the next one?
Yeah.
Let's do it.
All right. Mission 35. Enjoy the resort to the fullest. Slash sabbatical. Bragging about vacation.
Yes.
Originally aired December 9th, 2023, and adapts chapters 56 and 57, and is the final episode of the cruise adventure arc. In this episode, the cruise ship arrives at the resort island, allowing the Forgers to finally enjoy a family vacation together. After returning home, Anya learns why it's not a good idea to lie around a family of liars who are all trying to tell her not to lie.
So good.
More on that in a minute. In the adaptation of the In the adaptation of Chapter 56, there are some added scenes of the Forger's trip to the resort island, namely the Forger's visiting a cafe, a map of the resort town is shown, the Forger's reactions to seeing the horses before riding on them, and additional scenes of the Princess Lorelei leaving the resort island. An adaptation of Chapter 57 also features several anime-exclusive scenes, all of which are placed before the manga's chapter's contents, the segment opening with a sequence of Yor arriving at work and gifting a souvenir to Camilla, Millie, and Sharon, the souvenir in question being the skeleton keychain that Anya wanted Lori to buy her in episode 31, which I don't understand was on that ship in the first place, having been on cruise ships before. But anyway. There's also a brief flashback of Anya showing Yor the keychain to the store, which takes place during the cruise's return trip. After that, there's a scene of Yuri happily going to his locker and talking to the lieutenant about Yor being back from her trip. And there is a scene of Lloyd preparing the lovey-dovey marriage set from episode 8 in preparation for Yuri's visit. Three of the pictures of Yor inside Yuri's locker feature her in three of the outfits from the Yor's one-week coordinate bonus page in volume 3 of the manga. These photos were also in Yuri's locker in episode 9, but are more clearly visible in this episode. What are your thoughts on this one, Dallas?
This is back to that slice of life aspect about the show that I like, where it's just like, it's the sweetness, it's the kind of, this is, when I tell people about Spy Family, it's like, it's this like really cool, like spy show, and there's a girl that's she's psychic, but like, it's all very kind, it's all very sweet, and this is that return to that.
You have this, the word you're looking for.
You have the story arc, which in of itself, the whole story arc of the cruise ship was had elements of it, of the kindness, of the sweetness to it, and then we're back into it full force, where Anya's trying to, like, you know, impress everybody with her trip, and and Yor's like, here's gifts for everybody, and her coworker's like, why are you bringing me a keychain of a skeleton?
Why didn't you bring me wine so I could get boozed up?
Yeah, because
the considerable thing, people.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, it is a European work culture, so I'm sure it's totally not Germany.
No. Yeah, not Germany at all. Takes place in Berlin.
Berlin.
There's obviously Eastern and Western country. Communism's involved.
Yeah.
Yes. So, but it's just the sweetness of it, and even the creepy brother coming over to
see her,
his sister. There's a sweetness to it that I genuinely, this is one of the reasons why I love the series.
Also, I love Bond's reaction to seeing Anya in this episode.
Oh.
Finally, after a week.
Right. Like, it's just wholesome. And it helps ground the series, as ridiculous as it is, it helps to ground it to something special.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a very sweet episode because you get the Forgers, you know, being this fake family, kind of becoming a family. Like, they've gone this arc throughout all of season two and one and two. Mm-hmm. You have the moments where Yor is concerned because she be like her, what was it, Jonathan? Her hand, her boss,
Matthews.
Matthews, yeah, Matthews would be like, yeah, you want to cover your wound in your chest, and she's so concerned because it's Yor, and they're like, okay, let's do everything that Anya wants to do. Let's make her happy. And I mean, like, it's very, very sweet.
And Anya wants to swim with the fishies.
And we're going
to
swim with the fishies and all these wonderful little things. It's so incredibly cute. And it's just mm-hmm. a family becoming a fam, or a Forge mm-hmm. family becoming a family. And it's just a wonderful, sweet moment. And then it's more of the, you get little hijinks here and there. But again, it's a little slice of family. And it's very, very mm-hmm. sweet.
I did find it funny, the scene where Lloyd is carrying Anya
yeah.
and Yor at the same time.
Oh, that was funny.
That was funny.
And he's just like, this is awkward.
Yeah. I mean, everyone's like, staring at him as he's walking down the pier to the ship.
And he's able to carry both of them.
And right. and I can tell that is a very long pier to be carrying anything down.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Especially since, okay, having been on a cruise ship, I know you're going to get back to the ship. You're going to have to somehow check back into the ship so they mm-hmm. know you're back on there.
Yes.
And then work your way through the labyrinth that is the interior of that ship until you get up to wherever he laid Yor down so she could keep napping. Because couldn't go to the third class sure. room, because there's only two beds in there.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And the moment that, because I was watching this periodically because I would glance up. And the moment that got me, it was more, they're back in their stateroom. They're back in their stateroom, third class, which apparently there's no longer a third class anymore. Apparently,
no, you have a second class or first, you have second class staterooms, which are just regular ones like mm-hmm. Motel 6 style rooms, and then you have suites.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that moment where he puts
third class is where the crew sleeps.
Yes, as far as I said now. But that moment where Lloyd is put Anya up and be like, she falls down and he catches her, like, really, really sweet. Mm-hmm. She is out, doesn't even realize what's going on. How comfortably she is around this family.
Right.
Like, it's very, very sweet.
Definitely.
And also that scene of them all trying to patiently tell Anya, lying is not a good thing. It's not going to make you cooler.
Yes.
When you're sitting there going, Lloyd, your entire job is to lie.
Right.
Yuri, your entire job is to lie.
Mm-hmm.
Your entire job is to lie. Anya, you are also having to lie so you don't actually reveal all these other people's lies.
Right.
These aren't the Forgers. They're the liars.
It's fair.
It was that really weird, awkward moment at the end of this episode. It's like, yeah, you're all liars. And you're trying to tell this little girl not to be a liar. It's like the pot telling the kettle not to be black.
Mm-hmm.
Indeed.
You can't really do that. It's a bit hypocritical.
Yeah, a little bit. But it's so good. It's so funny. I'd be honest, I can't wait to finish this season. And then...
There's
two more episodes.
Next week.
And so do we have any clue when season three will come out?
To my knowledge, season three has not been announced yet.
Ah.
But and they probably won't until it's like... time for it to come out,
probably.
So it may be winter next year, it could be spring next year, it could be a year from now. That's what's weird about this.
Mm-hmm.
So
according to the great Dr. Google, third season of Spy Family is expected to be released in December 2023-2024.
We're past that
a little.
Oh wait,
well, that could 24 could be Okay, some people refer to season two as season three because they count the two halves of season one as separate seasons.
Ah.
So.
Yeah, I don't know. Get your acts right.
Yeah, Googles. That's why I'm not saying specifically when it's coming, because we don't know.
Mm-hmm.
I'm assuming in 2025.
Probably.
Just make it happen. I need more of this in my life. Okay,
You spent money to make a movie. You obviously have more show to make.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
and there's definitely more manga that you can adapt. So
word, as much again, and I say this as an avid anime fan, all right, and I mean avid anime fan. I love all the action, the drama. I love the deep thinking stuff, the stuff that makes you go feel and just, you know, man, the terribleness of life. But I need this sweetness here. And it not just be, and it not just be super like kiddie. You know what I'm saying? Like there's some stuff. It's just like, oh, this is clearly made for 2 year olds. You know, we don't want Coco Melon. Bump that kid, that football head out of the way. All right, we want this. Like, it's got something for everybody. So
that's because this is a family show, not a kid's show.
Exactly.
Not a teenager show. It's a it's a show for the entire family to watch and enjoy.
Exactly.
We need more of this.
Agreed.
I need more of this in my life, period, in one fashion or another.
Sure, there are scenes in here that make your teeth rot because of how sweet it is. But there's but it's followed by Lloyd and Yor kicking some major tail, or sometimes Anya kicking major tail.
That is true.
Followed by a poop god.
Followed by a poop god.
And a 20-minute song.
I don't remember it being 20 minutes, but okay.
It felt like it.
I was just laughing. Again, I'm waiting until December.
You'll find out soon enough. If you don't break down and rent it before then.
Maybe.
I have a request, Jacob. Watch the scene, I need somebody to get a timestamp of when this happens.
Okay.
And have Ash, I hope she's okay with me calling her Ash, Ashley, your bride, to hold up a camera and just record your reaction to it. I just need, that needs to go out publicly just to see your reaction to it.
Okay.
I will say when it happened in the theater, I couldn't, I wished I could have paused because I was laughing so hard I couldn't see what was going on.
There are some people that need to go see the poop god during that scene.
Indeed. You'll find out soon enough, Jacob.
Thanks. I'll let Ashley know. Be like, hey, can you record this?
So, like we said, next week we are finishing our season 2 coverage of Spy Family. Which means...
Yes.
We have to cover something else when we come back. So, at the end of our next episode, i.e., 7 days from this moment, we are going to close the poll on our Facebook group for picking the order of our next 4 TAS reviews. And right now, Batman the Animated Series is leading, followed by DuckTales 2018, whatever the new one is.
17.
And then followed immediately behind that by a tie between Gravity Falls and Star Trek the Animated Series.
Really? That would be called Wow.
So go vote. Switch all this up. Just go vote. To have your voice heard. Once you have done your civic duty as a U.S. citizen, United States, once you have done that, do your civic duty as a member of the Cell Nation and vote for our next TAS review.
Nice plug. Nice.
And join us next week for the final 2 episodes of Season 2 and technically the beginning of the next story arc, according to the Spy Family Wiki. And, we will catch you next time. Dallas, since you're our guest, you need to do some shameless self-promotion. Who are you and where can we find you at?
I am Dallas, and I am at geekdevotions.com, where you can find all kinds of devotions, podcasts, and everything, all taking geek culture, letting people know they're loved in a variety of ways. Again, geekdevotions.com, or just hit the YouTube side and go to Geek Devotions there.
All right. So,
and don't forget to check out Culture Box.
Always check out Culture Box.
Yes.
Media.
Yes. Yeah. So, in the meantime, this has been Drew.
This is Jacob. Blah, blah, blah.
And I'm Dallas.
And we'll catch you in the next frame.
You can follow Jacob on his Facebook at Jacob B. Heron.
I also need to update Facebook this.
Page, yes, you
Jacob's
do.
Jacob's Daily Art Corner, where he tries to draw each and every day.
I try.
His Instagram at Jacob B. Heron. His Twitter at Jacob Heron. And his Letterboxd at Jacob Heron. You can find Drew on Facebook at Drew Dodgen. His Facebook page, Drew's Photo Bin, to see his photography. His Letterboxd page at GGeorge759. His Twitter at GGeorge759. And Instagram at Drew Dodgen. You can like us on Facebook at The Cellcast Podcast. On Twitch at The Cellcast Gaming. on YouTube at CellCast, on Twitter at Cast_Cell. The CellCast can be found at Apple Podcasts, Google Play Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, or anywhere else fine podcasts are downloaded from. Please rate and review us where you found us and also on Podchaser. Email us at thecellcastpodcast@gmail.com. The CellCast is a proud member of both the Pop Americana and Culture Box media networks. For more information, please see the link in the description. Our theme song is Drop and Roll by Silent Partner. And remember, that's Cell with a single L.
Some terrorists are always trying to skate uphill.
Do you realize this is the only movie this month that did not include Frankenstein's monster?
You're touché. Good point. Touché. Squawk!